Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Loekendy. Senate Deputy Majority Leader John DeFrancisco is here with a last-ditch effort to make change through legislation. Hi, Senator.
How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm a little tired. We're at the very end of the session. Mm-hmm. We've been here for many hours for the last several days, but and the end is near.
Yes. The measures that we are going to talk about today are bills that you sponsored that would really restore public trust, help systems run smoother and more fair. One of your bills would allow more patients who are victims of preventable medical mistakes to seek justice in court. So tell us about this problem and your legislative solution.
Right. This is sometimes called Laverne's Law, and there's many papers that have talked about it for the last several years that I've been carrying the bill, and it's a difficult bill. Because you have every hospital and every doctor concerned about what the effects might be. But on the other hand, basically what the law does is this. Right now, let's take a woman who goes to a doctor or a hospital and they see a suspicious breast mass. And it turns out there's tests taken and so forth, and the doctor either doesn't see or the x-rays show when they don't read them properly or whatever. And it turns out that 3 years later, she's back to a doctor and the doctor sees the mass that's grown. And quite frankly, it's cancerous and the person could be in stage 3 or 4 of breast cancer. The person could not ever hold a doctor accountable for that, missing that and not telling the patient that they had a risk of cancer. Because the statute of limitations, the time within which you can bring the lawsuit as an aggrieved party, is 2.5 years. So what my bill basically does is this. Since the woman in this case had no clue there was a misdiagnosis, did not have any idea that there was anything wrong because the person was not told that, could now, once this problem is discovered by her, or should have been discovered, she could then still bring a lawsuit 2.5 years from the date of the discovery. You can't go back forever, as long as the negligence happened within the last 7 years, but the statute of limitations would go forward from the date that person would discover or reasonably should have discovered it. And so it provides a remedy for what could be a very, very serious condition as a result of the failure to diagnose or the failure to do follow-up. Now, this doesn't mean the doctor's negligence. It means that you could at least get into court to show the evidence, and then a jury or a judge determines whether the doctor was at fault or not. Now, to me, that's basically fair, because it's almost like the situation where you have an operation, and this was already in the law. You have an operation and the doctor leaves some small sponge in your abdomen. That's happened. But no way the patient would ever know that. But in the law always recognized that, okay, no way you can know about it. So once you find out about it, you have a period of time when you can now seek legal redress. This was not the case with these medical malpractice situations that I just mentioned. And I think it's a fair resolution of a serious issue.
Right. And it passed both houses?
It passed the Senate. It's expected to pass any minute now, the Assembly, and then it will go to the governor for signature. Or he can veto it, but I'm sure he won't. So that's, now, on the other side, the doctors are saying and the hospitals are saying it's going to cost a lot of money in malpractice and so forth and so on. Look, I've heard that many, many times when laws have changed for insurance companies. For example, there used to be a law called Timothy's Law. There was a father of a person who killed himself. He had mental problems, and he couldn't get any health care for that child because this insurance company didn't pay for medical health issues. I can remember he stood in the Senate in the gallery for years before this bill passed. And the insurance companies were saying, well, look, this is going to be raise rates 20% or 30%. We can't do it. And, well, finally, we did not think that that was really accurate, we passed the bill. Insurance rates have not increased appreciable at all. I don't even know if they've appreciated, gone up at all. So I think the same thing is going to happen here. But basically, you can't have a situation where someone's foreclosed from at least having it heard in court, whether there was negligence that caused serious, serious physical injury. Mm-hmm. So that's basically where we are with it. And I think it's taken years to get it done. And it wasn't easy getting it through the Senate. And I feel that it was the right thing to do.
DeFrancisco.nysenate.gov for more information. Now on to another bill you were able to get through that will give local commuters a break. Tell us how.
Yeah, this is on the other end of the spectrum, not nearly as serious, but important. Again, for years I've been sponsoring a bill that would provide for either no-cost or low-cost commuter pass on the thruway between exits 34A and 39. The reason that is that in many, many cases, in most cases, people getting to work, going into Syracuse or going out to the suburbs, their commute can be much shorter going on the thruway. There's less traffic, avoiding some of the main traffic areas, especially now with this soon-to-be reconstructed Route 81, whenever they decide how it's going to happen. It provides a quicker avenue, keeps cars from idling longer in traffic. And if the Thruway Authority passed both houses, Bill Magnarelli had it in the Assembly, it passed both houses, and basically it says that the Thruway Authority's got to develop either a no-cost or a low-cost tag or period, whether you got your easy pass, you can modify the easy pass so the cost is less during those exits on the Thruway. And so I think it's going to save money, and I think it's going to have more people on the thruway that aren't going, so that with the smaller charge that they're getting, I think will offset whatever people believe was lost revenue, because they're not going on the thruway every day. Mm-hmm. And so I tried it, and the reason I did it, I didn't do it because we're selfish in Syracuse. I did it because it was, I believe, a very important thing to get done, and it's been done before near Buffalo. So so I don't think we're chump change in Syracuse, and I think we should be treated the same way and provide that benefit, which will help the traffic congestion and I think save people money in the long run.
Now let's move on to criminal justice legislation. To start off, I want to cut to a part of a floor debate where you explain why, in certain circumstances, a defendant's record should be unsealed.
If I don't want to go through the criminal process and I want to get my case diverted, I should be willing, and I should put out my whole record so that a judge could determine whether I'm an appropriate candidate or not. So whether people have made mistakes before, the fact is this is a benefit that the person is asking for, and all this does is give the judge the whole story before making a decision. See, what the bill does, and it's pretty simple. And basically, there's instances where people who are involved in the criminal justice system can request that a case be diverted to some program or something rather than jail time, diverted to be handled in a way and then ultimately be dismissed, to give the person another chance. Well, there was an instance in New York City where such a person asked for the benefit of the diversion program. And at this time, the judge cannot get juvenile records and sealed records. So he based his decision, the judge did, on what was in the record at that point in time. Well, while this person was out on this program, whatever it may have been, he killed somebody. Now, obviously, people wonder, well, how the heck did this kid not go through the regular criminal justice process? And the reason is they didn't find out till later that he had a violent history of juvenile offenses. Now, as I was just mentioning on the floor, it seems to me that if I'm asking for some special break and the judge has to determine whether I'm worthy of it or not, I should be willing to open up my whole record. And if you don't want that record to be known, the one that's sealed, you shouldn't apply. So it's not that you have to apply. It's not that you have to open up these records that are normally sealed. But if you're looking for a benefit, and that's what this bill does. If someone applies for the judicial diversion program, they would literally have to open up, allow the sealed records to be open. And so that's what we're debating. The people that I was debating with, we didn't hear from them. They were saying, well, you know, one actually asked me, haven't you ever made a mistake? In other words, somebody makes a mistake, and then as a result of that mistake, they shouldn't have to live with that mistake forever. Well, my answer was no, I've never made a mistake. And everybody started laughing, and so did I, because that's obviously not true. But the point is that it's not that we're trying to penalize somebody because of a prior mistake. We're trying to help the individual. But to help them, we can't jeopardize the public safety. Yes. And we've got to see those sealed records.
Yeah, absolutely. In another effort to ensure fairness within the justice system, your bill that would create a commission on prosecutorial conduct was back in play this year. And just thinking about how it worked last year, the Assembly passed it. It was on the calendar. They didn't.
No, the Assembly did not pass it.
Oh.
The Assembly didn't even have it on the calendar. I had it on the calendar first, which means it's ready to be called and voted on. I think it was the last calendar, one of the last things we did. Mm-hmm. And then at the last minute, it wasn't called. And the Assembly hadn't done anything with it. And so it wasn't something ultimately was called, and as a result, it was voted on. So I've been continuing to work on it. Now the Assemblyman, and it did not pass the Assembly last year, now the Assemblyman claims he's going to try to get it passed. And he thinks he's going to get it passed, and quite frankly, he's called many times. We're now, as we're taping, we're probably in the last two calendars. My guess, it's probably not going to come up on our calendar, and it's probably not going to pass in the Assembly. But I'm doing everything I can to get it on the calendar and get it voted on, because what it does is, all it does is, the judges have it now. There's a separate body that reviews conduct of judges, and gives people the opportunity to at least make a complaint, have an independent body decide whether the judge acted properly, and go from there. And if it's not bad activity, if it's not improper, it's dismissed. If it's very improper, a person could be sanctioned or removed. That's what this would do with prosecutors as well. But obviously, for every person that likes a bill, prosecutors hate it. And so that's why there's this give and take all the time trying to get bills on the calendar.
You make another push for checks and balances with a bill that will restore oversight to the procurement process where billions of tax dollars are used for state contracts. You know, this upcoming federal corruption trial, you would think that this would have a little more traction.
You would think, and that's the problem. I put the bill in, basically a little background. Back in 2011, at the urging of Governor Cuomo, some of the contracts that the independently elected comptroller reviewed, that authority to review those contracts was taken away by the legislature. And the logic was, we're trying to move economic development projects, and in order to move them more quickly, let's take a step out of it so that it goes more quickly and get more economic development. Well, in my mind, it turned out to be wrong. There's all kinds of allegations of wrongdoing. There's some indictments that are going that are out there. Quite frankly, I don't know the details of them. But so a lot of good government groups are saying, we got to have some procurement reform. We've got to have someone overlooking the governor on these deals. Well, the best thing I can tell you is that the governor in his budget said, here's the solution. I want to have the authority to appoint an independent person, an inspector general, to do that review. Well, if he appoints the person that's reviewing his administration, I would think that that's like the fox guarding the hen house, and that didn't seem to me much of a reform. So we rejected it in the budget. Tom DiNapoli, the comptroller, submitted a bill that would basically reinstate what was the law back in 2011. The governor went apoplectic. He thought that was the wrong thing to do, called out everybody that he could call out to try to dissuade the legislature from doing the bill. I was actually on the opposite side trying to get people to put the bill on the calendar and get this in done because it's good government. To me, it was a no-brainer. Well, we're now at the last two rules committee meetings, which means the last two calendars are going to come out. It's not going to be on those calendars, which is quite frankly wrong in my mind. And the governor's strategy of trying to stop this bill looks like it's going to be successful, which I think is wrong. So as we start out with some of the things that I'm very happy about that's happening in the legislature today, these things I'm not happy about. But since I'm not the benevolent dictator and can decide everything, and there's a legislative process and a governmental process, you do what you can and you fight the next fights the following year, and that's what I intend to do.
All right. And I mean, we are talking about tax dollars, so if our viewers are watching this and they feel the same way that there needs to be independent oversight, what can they do?
Well, they can please continue to contact their legislators. It won't be acted upon this year because sessions is going to be over by the time people see this report here tonight. Just keep demanding that it be done, and hopefully I can reintroduce it next year and try to get some traction and get it done.
Yeah, one way to get it done and to really restore the public's trust would be maybe you run for governor.
Well, I've been asked that several times, but you never say never. But we'll just see what develops.
All right, Senator. All right. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For information on the bills we discussed today, as well as more legislation that's heading to the governor's desk to be enacted or vetoed, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.